So, myself is Kunjan Dalal, and I'm also known as Kunji. So, friends and Twitter people knows me as Kunji. And I'll be skipping other part of intro because we are having less time. So, we need to run. So, what happened? Oh, sorry. Okay. So, this is the agenda for today. So, this talk is basically designed for 45 minutes. But as there are other good talks on same topic, so it cut down to 20 minutes. And because of that, I'm cutting down a few of the stuff you may or may not be knowing, but we'll try to cover it after talk. So if you any question is there, just let me know. Not between the talk, after the talk. Let's start with the pop quiz. So first question, how many of you already know Elm? Have used it? Okay. How many of have used it in application, production level application in their project? Well, there are two people, great. Now this is the important question. How with you guys, how many times it happens that you've seen a cool demo in a conference and when you go back to your work, you can't convert that demo to a proper application? Like there is a cool thing happening for 1 hour, 45 minutes and you go back, you try to re-implement that stuff and it didn't work out. Oh, every time demo works out, that's great. Okay, so today we are not going to see demo. Instead, we are going to see something from the history. So it's not about what is possible, but it is all about what can be possible. So what is already become the history. So I'll be talking from my experience. The code sample will be in F# because F# is like general purpose programming language. It has strongly typed nature and it works for web and mobile servers, machine learning, anything you name it, you might find F# working there. There is a two things for Fable and Fable Elmish, or in general purpose we talk as Elmish. Fable is basically F# to JavaScript compiler powered by Babel. So basically it takes the F#, converts to AST and provides to Babel. Babel take that thing and converts to JavaScript. And Elmish is a abstraction layer or a library written in F# to give Elm style architecture to F# code. So basically if you want to create Elm style applications with F#, Elmish is the library to do that thing. We check out the code for both. Let's start with the Fable first. So here is the simple F# unit of measure code. So you provide the unit of measure to your types. So which is basically F# specific code. So this type of units you can give to your code and it will be very helpful when you are working with finance, research or biology, because it will not allow other types to compare or do the algebraic addition or subtraction. Means you can't compare meter with the feet if you are giving a type. When you convert this to a JavaScript using Fable, it becomes very dynamically type JavaScript language. This is generated JavaScript code. It generates ES6 code, I guess, which is more readable than what browsers can execute. Then you pass this to a Babel and it will convert this to a runnable JavaScript and it will run your application. Let's talk about the Elmish. This is your routine model. So this is similar to Elm. You have the model which of type, which has a property of value, which of type string, and then there is a message which is of change of value of type string. This is your state init function which initializes the value as a empty string, and update function which takes the new value and update the value with the new value. And this is the view which can show your model in a view, HTML view. You are writing this kind of HTML in Elm as well, and it will dispatch the event to the update method which eventually change the model, and again updated model will show the value and the view. So I guess this is very much what we do in Elm, so there is no much of a difference there. This is the wiring up, the same thing we are doing in Elm also. So you can wire it up, and this is the program with React. Elmish dash app is a div tag or div id which we take and run whole application in that div. So any questions till now, anyone feels that this is not similar to Elm, because it is very much. I learn Elm first and then move to Elmish. Okay, so let's go a little deeper. What is SPA? Anyone can explain me what is SPA? Yeah. Oh, that's not the SPA and Salon, the single page application. What they promise is you don't need to learn any other thing other than HTML, JavaScript, and CSS. Nothing else. It will give you that most powerful geometric diagram, a triangle, which is nothing miss. You learn that HTML, JavaScript, CSS, and nothing else you need to learn. But what really happens when you learn SPA, be it AngularJS or ReactJS or any other libraries, you have to learn many triangles. There are too many things. Oh, seriously. This thing also happens with SPA. There is no full screen mode. That's nice. Okay. So, anyone recognize who is this? That's me from the future. So, today I will be providing tips and tricks, and you have to just take it for granted, because just like you take every word for granted from old wise men. So, that is what it is. This is from experience, and when you get experience, you have wrinkles. So, we will be talking about model view update architecture, right? The Elm structure or the Elm architecture. So I strongly feel that in MVU architecture, model is the most important thing, because model is the message between update and view function. So if you are controlling the message, you are controlling the narration, right? Oh, come on. Yeah. Okay, that's a message tearing down, getting teared down. So I'll start my tips and tricks from the model itself. How you model the applications, and obviously how you model the model of model view update method. Let's talk about the model. Okay, so if you are having any kind of authentication, and I hope many of the application having that authentication structure, please divide your application into two part. One part where you need to be getting authenticated, and one part you don't need to get authenticated. So I normally start my application this way only. So it is having only two message, two page model in option type, either application or authentication, and then model will be having user token, which is having token or a token detail, and then the current page and the page model. Why I tell you? Can you see the line number 10 or 10-11, where I am checking the user token is none? So what happened when I was writing the application? I started with simple thing like login page should not check the user and other page should check the user. But that other pages start growing 10, 15, 25. So that user token is not none started growing again and again. So that is a repeated code I stack, and the page grows like anything. So it is better to refactor from very start if you are having any kind of authentication in that, in your application. For 2-3 pages, it is fine. But more than 10, 15 pages or 25 pages, it is better to get refactored. And one pro tip, if you are not using JWT, please use it. It is good for stateless applications. JWT is JavaScript Web Token. JSON Web Token, sorry. Page model. So in that application and authentication, if we are going deep for a page, this is how I normally like to define a page model. So there is a bad page model. So in bad page model, what happens is like you load all the pages at one shot. You are going into a application after authenticating a user, and then every application is getting loaded. So in good page model, only those pages are getting loaded which is you are seeing in the screen. So I started that way. I am loading almost everything, calling every API. It is asynchronous, it don't hurt, but soon your application started growing and it can go to the 7 or 8 level deep. So when you are changing the model, it becomes an issue. So instead of that, if you are taking an option type of it, it will only update the model which is required to be updated. This is a page model. So when you are on some page, how you want to define your components? So I normally like to divide components in separate components. So if you are having a page with a single big form also, I take 4 entries, 4 entries, 4 entries, I take a group of 4 randomly, give a random name, but make a smaller chunk. It will make a later code easier. A simple example, if you are having autocomplete based on a server API, so then you have to write client code and server code both. So it is better to abstract that component away instead of writing in a same file. Even just because it is the same page, you have to abstract that away. And even if there is a username authentication, that username should be valid based on some rules and regulation, and username should also be available on server. So you are doing server call and also a client call. So again, that username part, even though it is a simple text box, it should be abstracted away. Component model. So now we are very much narrowed down to a simple component, a simple piece of the page. We are almost halfway. If anyone like to take a break, I'll just drink it. We already take a break, right? Okay. Before we talk about the component model, let's talk about the domain-driven design. Anybody heard about domain-driven design here? Anybody using it in an application? Or anybody can say that they are using it right way? So if we can use domain-driven design on server side, why can't we use in domain-driven design in client side? It is very much possible. I started my application this way. So there is a validate type, then there is a person type, person error type, and my model looks like person is a person, then person error of type person error. This is very dumb implementation of domain-driven design, or how you represent a domain. So if a person is a domain, then you have the error. So whenever you are saying the person of person type should be very much valid only. So, but what happened when I am using with the Elm or Elmish way, when I want to update that first name should not be empty, a simple error message, I have to go through person error, then validate, and then message. It's like 3 or 4 level deep, just to update a simple model. It becomes more complicated when you are using this kind of types, or record types, either in Elm or F#. So how can you solve that problem? We can use Lenses, obviously. It is available in Haskell. Lenses are available in Elm. Also, it is available in F#. But if you have to use Lenses to update your record type, then definitely you are doing something wrong. So it is very much a good time to update the application structure. I use Lenses and then I spend 4 to 5 days just refactoring the whole code for not to use Lenses. Because one point of time, Lenses become more complicated to code with and also become slow. So I just flatten the model in a separate component. So there is a first name of first name component and last name of last name component. So first name can have their own separate update method which change the error or first name value, and last name also can have separate component which change the error message and value. Or you can do this way also. I just flatten straight away first name and first name error stays in a model. So I normally go with the rule that a model should not go more than one level deep. Lenses should not be there in your Elm or Elmish library. You can use it, but even the creator of Lenses in Elm, the Ivan, says no. If you are using Lenses, you are doing something wrong. Instead, start changing your code in a model view fashion. Let's talk about the command, the state part. Single responsibility principle. Normally, whenever we do to-do list or any simple sample application, we don't go this way, but this is more a useful way. If you are changing something, here I am converting string to upper, I am not updating model in the same command. If you are doing something, then do one and only one thing in that command itself. So change value is for converting that string to upper, then I am sending message to a change, so it happens, it authenticated, and then I am updating the value. So normally I go this way, command, I take a command to do something, maybe a post value to an API or changing something on a client side. And if it validated, the command is valid, then I'll move to the event or call change that, okay, now update the model. The everything is validated. It is event that happened. So now you can update the view. If you update the view. Another way to look at this is like you separate it with the command and events. So command will return only unit type. It will generate another message which will eventually update the model and which will eventually update the UI. So if you know CQRS, it is mostly happen this way. Command don't generate the events, it will not change the state, but event do. Just remember this slide specifically because it will be useful in future. Just two slides, after two slides. I'll talk about this again. And you can wire up command and event this way. It's a simple wire up, so. Yeah, sure. Subscribe. This is the least used feature when it comes to Elva. I've never seen that much of use of this thing. Subscribe is there to use, please use it. This is very default example of subscribe. You can subscribe to a clock to tick every second, and then every second it will change the model. This is kind of real-time use of subscribe. You are dispatching an event based on the real-time or reactive input you are getting from the server, be it server-side event or a socket. So here, if you are changing your commands into command and events, it will be useful because command just validate everything on a client side. It will go to the call the API, go to the server, validate it again, generate an event. Event comes via socket, push from the server to client, and from here, using subscribe, you can update the model. So it becomes more of a reactive application. Let's talk about the view. This is my favorite part. View should be simple and cute, like as small as possible and as cute as possible. Here I am just doing one thing, document table only. So there is nothing much more into view, but I like to keep root as simple as possible. So if someone is reading the root, it should get whole idea of the page. So if there are more than one thing, it should be like that. Even I can remove the document table and put the whole HTML code in the root. But instead of that, just keep it abstracted and writing, instead of writing comments that, okay, this is table code, make a separate function and give the proper name. So it will always easier to go to that view part and change it later. Use CSS wrappers. Okay, this is very useful when you are writing big projects. Instead of writing classes, you can easily create wrappers to write those classes for you. So you will not have spelling mistakes in CSS class, which normally happens for at least person like me who don't like CSS. And you can cut the code like anything. So for I have seen like 75% of reduction in my code after using wrappers. So you don't have to go nested DU and write classes and then go through that again based on your framework. This is Fulma is a wrapper around the Bulma CSS. And I never seen a Bulma CSS. I just go to the Fulma documentation and use it. Why I choose the Elmish instead of Elm? One language for server, client, be it web, mobile, data science, machine learning, data processing. I have done almost everything I written there. So I have worked with web, mobile, I have done data science thing, I have done machine learning and data processing, be it server or web. Possible to leverage JavaScript library. Fable provides you a bridge between JavaScript and F#. So even you can access dynamic part of JavaScript without any issue. Even the in same code you can write function in JavaScript, you can access in F#. You write function in F#, you can access in JavaScript. Possible to leverage React libraries. There are a hell lot of libraries which is already created. So instead of letting it go, I can use it easily with my Elmish architecture. Because of all this, I can use the acquired knowledge throughout the years. So basically, it's almost 11 years in software. So learning new things doesn't mean that I should forget all about things. So whatever libraries and whatever names I know, be it React or be it any other libraries, I can use it easily. This is React Leaflet code, if you can see the code. So it is basically a library to create maps. And this is the F# Elm code I'm writing. And this is the result, you can create maps easily. So we are not we don't have to create whole library altogether just to support maps. There is awesome toolchain available. This is HTML to Elmish, which is same as HTML to Elm that is available. You give the HTML code, it will convert to the Elmish code. There is another good thing is TS to Fable. So you give the TypeScript definition, it will convert the F-sharp definition for you. So you can use any TypeScript definition. It will convert for you. It will convert that thing to F-sharp. So you can easily use it in Elmish project without any issue. So any JavaScript library, you can use it, including jQuery, I have seen. But not with Elmish, with the Fable. So I guess, thank you. That's done from my end. These are the links. There is an awesome Fable which I am maintaining. Safe stack is a complete stack, like main stack. It will generate the server side shared code and client side code for you, which will be having a server side refresh. So if you change the server side code, it will refresh the whole thing. If you change the client side code, it will do hot reload for you. All thing will be set up. You can share code, you can share the domain part, you can share the validation thing. You can do railway oriented programming on both sides. I have done that. What the F-sharp Elmish? This is the talk where me and the creator of Fable was talking about Elmish. So you can listen to that talk. Fulma is a wrapper I already told. Balero is another thing launched 2 days back, which convert your Elmish code to the WebAssembly. So you can go even more native to that browser. And Fable, you already know. Just check out the REPL. You can run F-sharp code without any internet. So it runs, compile F-sharp code in your browser. And this is the consulting I started recently. Right now, there are not much people. This is the Fable compiler, Twitter handle, and me. So if there is any comments, good comments, you can tag the Fable compiler. Bad comments, you can tag me. I always try to improve that thing. Questions? We don't have time, I guess. Sure. It's Sudipta only. We can cut his time. Any questions, I'll be here for today and tomorrow. Just let me know. And thanks.